विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर शत श्री श्रीमद्भय चरणारविंद भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर शत श्री श्रीमद्भक्ति सिद्धांत सरस्वती गोस्वामी महाराज श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय। नामाचार्य श्रील हरिदास ठाकुर की जय। प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद की जय। श्रीमद्भागवतम की निताय गौर प्रेमानंद हरि हरि बोल। All glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories, all glories, all glories to Shri Shri Guru and Shri Gauranga. We are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, second canto, third chapter, devotional service and text number 9. Rajya kamo manun devan niruttim tvabhicharan yaje kama kamo yaje somam अकाम पुरुषं परम। राज्य कामो मनुं देवान् निरुत्तिं त्वभिचरन् यजे काम कामो यजे सोमम्। अकाम पुरुष परम राज्य कामो मनुं देवान् निरुत्तिं त्वभिचरन् यजे काम कामो यजे सोमम्। अकामः पुरुषं परम् राज्य कामो मनुं देवान् निवृत्तिं त्वभिचरन् यजेत् काम कामो यजेत् सोमम्। अकामो पुरुषं परम् राज्य कामो मनुं देवान् चरन् यजेत् काम कामो यजेत् सोमम्। अकामं पुरुषं परम् निवृत्तिं सर्वविचरं काम कामो यजेत् सोमम्। काम पुरुषं परम् देवान् काम पुरुषं परम् च कामो मनुं देवान् निरुत्तिं त्वभिचरन् यजे चित्समम्। अकाम पुरुषं परम् माताजी निरुत्तिं त्वभिचरन् यजेत् काम कामो यजेत् सोमम्। अकाम पुरुषः परम् पुरुषं परम् ओके विल रीड synonyms rajya kamah anyone desiring an empire or kingdom manun the manus, semi-incarnations of God, devan, demigods, nirutim, demons, tu, but, abhicharan, desiring victory over the enemy, yajet, should worship, kama, kamaha, one who desires sense gratification. Yajet, should worship. Somam, the demigod named Chandra. Akamaha, one who has no material desires to be fulfilled. Purusham, the supreme personality of Godhead. Param, the supreme. The translation and purport by His Divine Grace Abhay Charanaravinda Bhaktivedanta Swami Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. The translation, one who desires domination over a kingdom or an empire should worship the manus. One who desires victory over an enemy should worship the demons. And one who desires sense gratification should worship the moon. But one who desires nothing of material enjoyment should worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Srila Prabhupada's purport. For a liberated person, all the enjoyments listed above are considered to be absolutely useless. Only those who are conditioned by the material modes of external energy are captivated by different types of material enjoyment. In other words, the transcendentalist has no material desires to be fulfilled, whereas the materialist has all types of desires to be fulfilled. The Lord has proclaimed that the materialists who desire material enjoyment and thus seek the favor of different demigods, as above mentioned, are not in control of their senses and so give themselves to nonsense. One should therefore not desire any sort of material enjoyment, being sensible enough to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The leaders of nonsensical persons are still more nonsensical because they preach openly and foolishly that one can worship any form of demigod and get the same result. This sort of preaching is not only against the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita or those of the Srimad Bhagavatam, but is also foolish, just as it is foolish to claim that with the purchase of any travel ticket, one may reach the same destination. No one can reach Bombay from Delhi by purchasing a ticket for Baroda. It is clearly defined herein that persons impregnated with different desires have different modes of worship, but one who has no desire for material enjoyment should worship the Supreme Lord, Shri Krishna, the Personality of Godhead. And this worshiping process is called devotional service. Pure devotional service means service to the Lord without any tinge of material desires, including desire for fruitive activity and empiric speculation. For fulfillment of material desires, one may worship the Supreme Lord. But the result of such worship is different, as will be explained in the next verse. Generally, the Lord does not fulfill anyone's material desires for sense enjoyment. But He awards such benedictions to worshippers of the Lord, for they ultimately come to the point of not desiring material enjoyment. The conclusion is that one must minimize the desires for material enjoyment. And for this, one should worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is described here as Param, or beyond anything material. Shripad Shankaracharya has also stated, Narayana Paro Avyaktat, the Supreme Lord is beyond the material encirclement.
ओमज्ञान तिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामैहं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च नमाम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी निति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्ण। सो दिस श्रीमद् भागवतम द पर्टिकुलर वर्ड्स दैट वी आर रीडिंग इट इज टॉकिंग हाउ there is a material world which is also called kunta. Like Srila Prabhupada was mentioning this Sunday's class, kunta means the place where there is misery, and there is a world that is beyond this place of misery that is called vaikunta. Vai means that is without, kunta means suffering. So there are two types of oceans that have been mentioned, two types of unlimited vast oceans, and the living entity has the choice to choose which ocean he wants to drown himself. So drowning is not a choice. There is material world that is like material ocean, sansara sagara. As they say, like Krishna says, Tesham aham samudharta mrityu sansara sagarat, the ocean of birth and death. So the material world is ocean of birth and death, where the living entities are constantly suffering, where all the living entities are drowning, they are suffocating, and they are being harassed by the three modes of material nature, and there is constant change of body. They're being forced to die and accept another body. So that's why it's the sansara chakra, the sansara sagar. And Prahlad Maharaj says, Trastosmiham kripana vatsala dussahogra sansara chakra kadanad grasatam pranita. All the acharyas, they have been telling us that this material world, the ocean of material miseries, all the living entities, how badly they are being harassed in that ocean. And there are always different tides coming. This ocean is constantly angry ocean. So there will be always some big, big waves that are going to come, and they are going to push you down, and they are going to make you drown. Different waves, the wave of coronavirus. Nobody expected that, but it just appeared and everybody found themselves under it. Nobody wanted the wave of unemployment, the wave of breakup with a girlfriend. Any type of wave, they come unexpectedly and they make us completely suffocated in this ocean of material miseries. On the other hand, there is the second ocean, that is the ocean of love, of Krishna's unlimited eternal mercy, the ocean of unlimited love that comes from Krishna. And what type of ocean it is, where the devotees, they voluntarily want to be drenched. They voluntarily want to be drawn in that ocean, because that's the ocean of eternal, unlimited bliss. Like Narottam Das Thakur prays, Gaura Prema Rasaranave Se Taranga Jeba Dube Se Radha Madhava Antaranga Gruheva Vane Se Thake A Gauranga Boli Dake Narottam Mage Tava Sanga. Narottam Das Thakur says, Oh my dear Lord, please give me the association of those devotees who are happily drowning in the ocean of love of Sri Gauranga Mahaprabhu. It doesn't matter Grihe va Vane se Thake. Doesn't matter whether they are living in the house or they are renunciates living in the jungles. The only condition is whoever is chanting A Gauranga, whoever is chanting the names of Gauranga, A Gauranga, Gauranga, whoever is chanting, please give me their association. A Gauranga Boli Take Narottam Mage Tava Sanga. Narottam Das is hankering for the association of such devotees. So now here, natural question is, if there are these two oceans, and why are we in this ocean now? We could have chosen the other ocean, right? Because there are so many nice things I'm talking about. The other ocean looks very promising, beautiful. The material world is created, this ocean is for those swimmers who don't want to follow any rules. They don't want to follow any direction or dictation. They want to be the controllers. Such people land up in this type of ocean. So Srila Prabhupada was once asked, why a living entity desires to come into this material world? This is such a vast ocean of suffering. Why does a living entity find himself in such an ocean? Srila Prabhupada said, one time he said, that it's causeless stupidity. Another time he said that many a times a living entity comes in order to drink soma rasa, to drink wine and enjoy with woman. That's the reason a living entity may come, out of curiosity to find out what is there to offer in this ocean. So many a times Srila Prabhupada tells how this material ocean of suffering is constantly holding. It's like a prison house. Srila Prabhupada gives this example. But what a beautiful and what a wonderful prison house has been created by Krishna, where all the prisoners, they think they're free. There are no shackles, no bars. Everyone feels, I am free. And Ishwaro aham bhogi, siddoham balavan sukhi. Everyone thinks, I am the controller, even though he's in the prison house. I am perfect. I am the most powerful. And I am the enjoyer. What kind of prison house? There is no shackles. But everyone is already in the prison house. But Srila Prabhupada mentions there are shackles, but we don't see them. And what type of shackles there are? The shackles of material desires. So the material desires a living entity imbibes or holds on to, those shackles, they are invisible, but still they bind us. So in this purpose, Srila Prabhupada mentions the different first three lines are about those shackles only. Rajya kamo manun devan. People who are desire for domination over a kingdom or empire, they worship manus. Then the second shackle. Niruttim tvabhicharan yajet. One who desires victory over an enemy should worship the demons. Kama kamo yajet somam. And one who desires sense gratification should worship the moon. Now, first three lines of this verse are talking about those shackles only, which are invisible. And then finally is akama purusham yajet. So, Srila Prabhupada only is focusing on that last line. First three lines, Srila Prabhupada is not talking much. Because the most important thing is how to break off these shackles. Once you break off these shackles, then you can actually enter that another ocean of eternal bliss rather than suffering into this ocean. So, here in this particular material world, everyone is intoxicated thinking, I am the controller, I am the enjoyer. And whenever a living entity thinks in that fashion, Krishna has a beautiful way to remind all of them that it's a prison house. Don't you forget that. So, lock down. Sometimes Krishna reminds, lock down everybody. Get inside yourselves. There is one beautiful small pastime of Bhima. When all the Pandavas were exiled for 12 years and then 1 year of incognito, so in that period all the Pandavas would go together to bring fruits, vegetables and wood and to help Draupadi. But one time Bhima woke up with bad mood and he was feeling that nobody cares for me, nobody understands that I'm so powerful, nobody gives me that respect. So Bhima went alone. He started walking towards the forest. While walking, he was thinking, Ishwaro hamaham bhogi siddho ham balavan sukhi. I'm so powerful, I have the strength of 10,000 elephants. So whenever he would see a huge, enormous tree, he would uproot the tree and throw it in the sky. And he started walking, breaking all the trees, destroying the jungle. And he started going inside. He came across beasts. He came across lions, tigers. And he would show them strength. I am so powerful. What do you think of yourself? He would literally kill, rip them apart and walk all the way inside. He was walking. All of a sudden, it happened that there was a huge snake. And the snake saw this puffed up person. The snake grabbed him in his coils and hold him tight. So the Bhima who was thinking himself to be so powerful and creating such a chaos, he found himself locked down in the coils of that snake. He couldn't even move. He couldn't believe that it's just this snake. I just fought with so many other bees and killed them. It's just a snake. He asked, who are you? The snake replied, my name is Nahusha. And one time I also was like you, puffed up. One time I also thought, Ishwaro aham bhogi. Siddoham Balavan Sukhi. I'm the most powerful. I'm God. I'm the controller. I'm the enjoyer. And I was the king of the heavens in the previous Manvantara. My name is Nahusha. I was Indra. And I was so puffed up. I started to feel I'm God. And I started to harass Brahmarshis. I was so puffed up. And when Lord Brahma saw my condition, he cursed me to become this enormous, gigantic snake. And I started to cry. I started to beg to Lord Brahma that I'm really sorry. Please, don't give me such a curse. But then Brahma said that one day when a person will come to you and he gives you the science of self-realization, when he will give you the knowledge of your true self, then you will go back as a resident of heavenly planets, but not as Indra, but you will become a resident, you will go back. So Bhima started to feel very hurt. He started to feel bad about himself, that I was so puffed up. I was so puffed up, I started to think that I am the most powerful, but now I am locked down. So when the human society as a whole thinks that there is no need of a God, when human society becomes puffed up, proud of their so-called teeny tiny insignificant accomplishments, they think there is no need of a God. We are God. We are better than God. Scientists many times they claim that we can do even better than God, because they don't know who is God. So at such a time, Krishna has to humble human society, and then Krishna has to show that you are thinking of yourself to be God. Now, just a teeny tiny, invisible virus is making you locked down. You can't even come out of your houses. Now, if we see our pitiable situation, even the big, big leaders, the scientists, they all couldn't even come out of the homes. Everyone was so much scared. Everyone has been living a life of a prisoner. The same walls of their homes of comfort that they used to think have become the walls of prison house. So sometimes when the human society becomes puffed up, and the scientists, when they ask you, show me God, where is your God? Show me your God. So now you can also ask, show me your coronavirus. Where is your coronavirus? The scientists will say, oh, it is invisible. It exists, but it is invisible. You can't see with your eyes. Your eyes are limited. That's what we were telling you in the past. But the scientists will say, but there is a way to understand the virus exists by its symptoms. Just the same way we, like Srila Prabhupada has been telling, God exists even though you may not see God, but you do see the symptoms of existence of the ultimate supreme creator. Srila Prabhupada used to say that this entire world, the way it is organized, operated, it is all in the proper fashion. The way all the planets are revolving around the sun, it's a symptom that God exists. When a baby is born, at that time, there is also milk that is produced in the body of the mother. It's a symptom, the existence of God. There are so many such symptoms that we can tell. When we eat, sometimes we even forget what we have eaten. Many times we just gulp pizza, pasta, this prasad, that prasad, paneer, and we don't even remember. We just go to sleep, and who is digesting? So that's a, like Krishna says that he is aham vaishwanaro bhutva praninam deham ashrita pachamyannam chaturvidham. He says, I am the one who digests your food. So these are all symptoms of existence of God. Now, coming back to the situation where Bhima is locked down, he can't even move. And he is completely humbled. Now he says that I don't have the highest knowledge that you are looking for. That you are looking for the Atma Gyan. You are looking for the ultimate knowledge about true self. But my brother is very smart. Yudhishthir Maharaj, he is the smartest. He must be looking for me. So in the meanwhile, the Pandavas started to search for Bhima. And then it was easy to find where the Bhima was because of the kind of chaos he created. So it was easy to find the path. They just traced the path of all the broken trees, all the dead tigers, lions. And then they heard that somebody is shouting, "Oh, Yudhishthir, help me." So then Yudhishthir Maharaj understood, okay, something is happening. When Yudhishthir Maharaj came, Nahusha told all the story, how he ended up being such a snake. And he asked Yudhishthir Maharaj, "So do you have the knowledge that can free me from this body of snake?" So that time Yudhishthir Maharaj said, "You ask me whatever question and I'll try to answer." So it's a beautiful, very beautiful passage. Vyasadev, he mentions how nicely Yudhishthir Maharaj is answering all the questions. Who is perfect householder? Who is the perfect sannyasi? Who is a brahmachari? Who is real kshatriya? What are the duties of the king? Different questions being answered by Yudhishthir Maharaj. Then Nahusha started to ask, what happens? What are the symptoms of Satya Yuga? What are the symptoms of Dwapar Yuga? What are the symptoms of Treta? What are the symptoms of Kali Yuga? Because Nahusha wanted to know what is coming up. Yudhishthir Maharaj said, Kali Yuga is really dreadful. It is going to be very difficult. In Kali Yuga, the grihasthas will become grihamedis. They will be attached to only sense enjoyment. In the Kali Yuga, brahmacharis, they may be pure on the bodily platform, but on the mental platform, they will be constantly impure. They will be tested. And they will always be in two minds, whether to get married or to remain brahmachari. Sannyasi, you will not find a sannyasi. Very, very rarely in the age of Kali, if the God is very merciful on you, you may find a sannyasi. The Shudras will take the responsibility of Vaishyas. They will open their businesses and they will start to earn money. And because they are Shudras, they will start to take more money. Vaishyas will try to control like Kshatriyas, and we see that is happening. Because Vaishyas have a lot of money, they try to use the money to gain the control like Kshatriyas. Kshatriyas will use their power to act very saintly, and they will start to act like Brahmanas. And very dying age, he starts to explain everything. The minds will be polluted. All the people will be corrupt. And at the age of 7, in the future, a lady will start getting pregnant at the age of 7. At the age of 11, a boy will start to become father. At the age of 16, there will be old age beginning. So when Nahusha is listening, he said, "Stop it, I don't want to listen more. This is too much. Tell me only one thing. Now, if this is the situation of the people in the future, now that means I'm going to stay the snake forever. Because all the, you know, big dynasties of fools coming up in the age of Kali." So he said, "You are my only hope. Tell me the last thing. What is the best way, even in such a dying age of Kali, what is the best way to realize one's true identity? How to connect to one's true self?" And that time Yudhishthir Maharaj, he said, even in such a very worst of the worst situation in the Kali Yuga, just by performing devotional service unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is none other than Krishna, one can clearly cross over this ocean of material miseries. Only by remembering his activities, only by remembering his holy names, one can very easily swim across this ocean of material suffering and actually enter the ocean of real happiness. As soon as Nahusha heard this, he started to remember and meditate on the lotus feet of the Supreme Person, Krishna. And he changed into a heavenly personality and went back. Ekantino yasena kanchanartham vanchanti evai bhagavat prapannaha ati adbhutam tat charitam sumangalam gayantam anand samudramagnaha. The greatest of the great, the purest of the pure devotees of Krishna, they have not a tinge of material desire. And that's why they are constantly and happily, they are drawing themselves into the ocean of bliss. That is Krishna's devotional service. Devotional service and remembrance of the beautiful form, the beautiful pastimes of Krishna. By that, Gayantam Ananda Samudramagnaha. They are constantly happily drowning in the ocean of spiritual happiness and bliss. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Questions? Anybody questions, comments? Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Granthara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.
About that, you know, those first couple of paragraphs, nectar of instruction.